fishes are really unique as they complete half of their life cycle in fresh water and the remaining half in salt water. So this is a really interesting phenomena that we would be understanding today. And Ketodromous and Endromous are two types of fishes which are part of the diadromous fishes. So diadromous fishes, as we said, are nothing but those fishes that they complete their life cycle in both fresh water as well as the salt water. Now, since they are moving from fresh water to salt water, one of the things is very important to understand is the ionic balance. The ionic balance of the fishes within the salt water and the fresh water would differ because the salt concentration outside in a salt water is much higher as compared to fresh water. So they need to constantly adjust themselves, and therefore they are also known as eurihaline, which we would understand in a while. But to talk about diadromous fishes, we can classify those as ketodromous and endromous. So let's understand what is ketodromous and what is endromous, what are their examples, and how we can best remember these two types of classification. So the first classification is the ketodromous. Now ketodromous are those fishes which are down running. Now how do we understand this? Understand that seawater and fresh water is there. Now rivers that come as a source of fresh water merge with the salt water. So rivers are originating from a higher elevation and ocean are at a lower elevation. So the fishes are moving from higher elevation and going towards lower elevation, and therefore ketodromous fishes are called as downrunning fishes. Now again, a good way to remember this is kata, or you can remember it as cut. So let's say I have a sheet of paper, I cut it. What would happen? I'm holding one side, cutting it, so the other side would go down. And the same happens with ketodromous fishes. So they start their life cycle from the fresh water moving into the salt water. In this process, what happens is they lay the eggs in salt water and then they further move back to the fresh water. One very good example of ketodromous fishes are eels. Again, it is very important to note that these fishes, be it the ketodromous fishes or the endromous fishes, they end their life cycle once they lay the eggs. Now, as soon as they lay the eggs, what happens is their life cycle ends. That means the fishes no more exist. And there is a bout. Bout means there is an ample of eggs that they lay at one point of time, and then they do not or they cannot survive further. So they start their life cycle from the fresh water, lay the eggs in salt water, and then those larvae and fishes move back to the fresh water. And this is how the life cycle of ketodromous fishes is completed. They are born in salt water, they mature in fresh water, to spawn they move back to salt water, and further at that point they die, and the new birth that takes place, they are born in salt water and they move to fresh water. Some of the good examples of ketodromous fishes are eel. So European eel, American eel, long-finned eel, short-finned eel are some of the examples. Besides that, inanga is another important example as a fish for ketodromous. Now, coming on to the next is andromous fishes. Andromous fishes show a behavior which is reverse of ketodromous fish. That means what happens is they lay their eggs in fresh water and the fishes move to the salt water with the flow, with the current of the water from the fresh water. So the river that is flowing bring those eggs to the salt water, and from the salt water the fishes move back to the fresh water. And since they are moving from salt water to the fresh water, they are moving upwards. As we said, the elevation of the fresh water would be relatively higher than the salt water, so they are moving upwards, and therefore endromous fishes are also known as upward running fishes. So that is one of the important things that you need to remember. And another important thing is they reproduce in fresh water, in contrast to Cataramus fishes which reproduce in salt water. But again, their life cycle remains the same and they end their life once they give birth to the eggs, or the eggs are hatched. Now, what are the examples for endermous fishes? Most of the examples start with S, so that is how you can remember it. Now, some of those are salmon, shad, so American shad and hickory shad. Then you have sturgeon and smelt. One example which does not have S with it and is important is lamprey. So lamprey is another fish. But as you can see, most of the fishes, be it Cataramus or Andromus fishes, are sleek, thin, long fishes and they can easily move with water currents or water flow. And therefore, they are part of this diadromous fish cycle or the urihaline circulation. Now, as we talked about the concept of urihalinity, which is very, very important. Now, let's talk about the salt water first. We are much familiar with the word salt water. Definitely, it has salt in it. So the concentration of ions outside is much higher as compared to the fish. So in order to take the challenges, the fish needs to conserve the water. So what would happen is the fish would intake a lot of water but excrete very less nitrogenous waste. So that is how fishes behave in salt water. Now, how do this happen? This whole thing, the excretion of salt cells occurs through either the gills or the lining of the fishes, which is also known as integument. So that you would understand further when we have other lectures of biology about pisces. But the idea is the outer lining is the integument and gills. Those are two of the organs that would help in salt excretion. Now, this is what happens in a saltwater fish. What happens in a freshwater fish is a little reverse of it, because the concentration of ions in the body of fish is much higher as compared to outside region, and therefore it requires less water intake and excretes more nitrogenous waste. Now, what would happen for a diadromous fish? Definitely, a diadromous fish would have to maintain its balance both in the salt water as well as the fresh water. So what it does is, it maintains itself in fresh water. It has more ions within its body. It consumes less water, excretes more. But the same fish, when it moves to salt water, it intakes a lot of water and excretes very less nitrogenous waste. So that is how the same fish behaves differently in the two conditions, and therefore they are known as urihaline fishes. That is, they have a capability to adjust themselves in freshwater versus saltwater. Now, as we said, diadromous species, be it the Cataramus or Andromus, are very, very unique. Why? Because they reproduce in one large bout and then they die. Therefore, they are known as cimaloporous species. Cimaloporous species are those species that reproduce once and then they die. However, there are other species, for example, take example of pigeon, take example of cats, dogs. These species reproduce constantly and therefore they are known as iteroparous species. So iteroparous species are another species which are in contrast to cimaloporous species, but these diadromous fishes are cimaloparous in nature, and therefore it is very, very important concept that you need to know. So this was a quick overview about what are Cataramus and what are Andromus fishes, a very, very important and indeed an interesting topic. Similarly, we do have Amphidromus, Potamodromus species. Now, as we talked about the Andromus species, which lay eggs in the fresh water and completes its life cycle in the salt water, a similar concept is seen with Potamodromus species, but that cycle is completed within the fresh water itself, which we would understand in a separate lecture. So stay tuned for many more updates from our side. Have a wonderful day ahead.